He hates it when we do that.
I hate it. It's only happened twice in 25 years, so I do love it from all of you. Thank you so much. Kevin did better this service. Last service, he said that I was a century old. I'm like, dude, I'm a half century old. So 51 years, and the Lord has blessed me to spend so many of them here with you. And so thank you for the birthday wishes. So many of you wrote and took time. Forrest, where's Forrest this morning? I think he met Forrest back there. Forrest is 19 today, so our drummer. So happy birthday to you as well, Forrest. You're an old man, so welcome to the club. We're in John chapter 12 this morning, so if you'll turn there with me to John chapter 12, we are continuing our study in the book of John. This is a story that many of you have heard, but most of you have probably heard this story preached out of other texts. As you know, we have the Synoptic Gospels, which are the accounts of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then we have John's gospel. And many times John's gospel kind of stands alone and by itself with the stories that are shared and are told there. But this is one of the times that actually he shares a story that is in the synoptics as well. And this story most times is preached out of Matthew chapter 26 or Mark chapter 14. Most times it's actually put right before the betrayal of Jesus. It's normally put at the end of the Gospels, where this seems to be like it's a little earlier. But remember, much of the book of John really is about the last week of Jesus' life. So we are getting to the end. The other writers that tell of this story, it really seems to be about Judas. There are some things that are going to be revealed about Judas in this story, and we go from this story into his betrayal and to the point where we start to learn that he is going to forsake Jesus for silver, and we know that he sells Jesus out, and eventually Jesus is taken to trial. He's crucified. Judas eventually hangs himself. And so most times when we think about this story, we learn something about Judas. It's why the other writers put it kind of next to his betrayal, because we get an insight into what's been going on in the life of Judas. But I think this is really the better context where John puts this story, because this story ultimately is about extravagant worship. While we learn some things about Judas, and Judas is kind of contrasted against Mary here, I think the beauty of this story is found in the act of what Mary does at the feet of Jesus when he takes an ointment that is worth a whole lot of money, and she pours it over his head and over his feet, and she wipes his feet with her hair. And if you remember in this story that eventually the disciples, and it's not just Judas, but the disciples step up with Judas, and they start to argue about, was this a good use of money? How could you take something so expensive and pour it over Jesus? It could have been given to the poor. And Jesus responds to them and defends Mary and the worship that she is giving to Jesus. Folks, when it comes to extravagant worship, we only worship Jesus in an extravagant way when we see him for who he truly is. When we understand the fact that we serve a risen Savior. We understand the fact that Jesus is the one who came and died and gave his life so that we could be forgiven and we could be set free. For Mary, she's looking at Jesus, and I want you to see where this story really fits is at the next day or the next days after Lazarus is raised from the dead. When we see why she did this amazing act, this extravagant act of worship, this clear display of love, it was because we find that in the beginning of chapter 12, Lazarus pops back up into the story, and they are sitting in a home, and no doubt they are listening to the words of Jesus. No doubt they are filled with awe and wonder, because not only is Lazarus there, but we find out in the other Gospels, it doesn't tell us exactly where this is taking place in John, but in Matthew and Mark, it tells us that it's at Simon the leper's house. And it probably wouldn't be better to say Simon the ex-leper, because if he still had leprosy, there would not have been a party at his house. This was a man who evidently had come across Jesus, and Jesus had healed this man of his leprosy. So sitting, imagine reclining at a table, and you have Jesus there teaching, and you've got Lazarus in the flesh, the man who was dead for 4 days, has been given back to Mary, has been given back to Martha. Do you think that their hearts were filled and stirred with love at that moment? Do you think that they were in awe and wonder that when Jesus said, in John chapter 11, I am the resurrection and the life. It wasn't just words for them. They saw Jesus resurrect Lazarus. They saw Jesus heal Simon, no doubt, Simon the leper. He's sitting there. Could you imagine the testimony? Could you imagine what they all must have been sharing, how they must have been so filled with joy, so filled with worship at that moment that Mary does something that shocks everybody. Now, Martha didn't shock anybody because Martha's doing what Martha always does. The way that she worshiped was to serve. Says that she was doing what we always find her doing. She was back there cooking and she was back there serving the meal, because we know that really when you look at Martha over and over in Scripture, that's how she was wired. That's what she did in order to serve the Lord. But we want to see the devotion of Mary today. Have you gotten over the love of God? I read a story about a medieval monk who was asked to give a lesson in chapel one day. And normally it was during the day, and he was asked to give a lesson on the love of God. And so rather than meeting during the day, he asked everyone if they would instead come in the evening. And once it had begun to get dark, he allowed the sanctuary to get completely dark to where they could not even hardly see each other. And suddenly when he began, he simply lit a candle and he walked over to the crucifix. And he held that candle to the crown of thorns. And he left it there for a moment. And then the candle moved and he put it to the right hand of Jesus, pierced with the nail. And he left it there for a moment. And then he went to the left hand of Jesus, pierced with a nail, and he left it there for a moment. He took that candle and he shone the feet of Jesus, where again his feet were crossed and his feet were pierced with a nail. And he raised the candle to the side of Jesus. And at this point, he hadn't said a single solitary word. And when he had left it there at the side of Jesus for a moment, he simply blew out the candle. And as the room darkened, his message was this simple: this is the love of God. Does that stir you? What Jesus has done for you. That like Lazarus, you were dead, but he's made you alive. You remember what it was like to be a slave to sin. You remember what life was like when you were completely out of control and you were ruining and damaging everything that mattered to you, every relationship. But Christ came in and he gave you new life. And because of the cross and because of his burial, because of his resurrection, your life was transformed. And folks, I hope that we never get over it, because we ought to be worshipers like Mary that give extravagantly. I want to read to you John chapter 12, verses 1 through 11. It says, Jesus, therefore, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. There's a lot in that one little verse. Remember, we ended chapter 11 with, they wanted to kill Jesus. Because he raised Lazarus from the dead, they wanted Jesus dead. They knew that people would begin to believe, that people would begin to follow. And you remember John did a wonderful job last week talking to you about the fact that they were so consumed with their power and their position and their place that they were willing to kill Jesus, this one who gave life. Because he was a threat to them, to their life, to their plans. And Jesus got out of the public eye for a few days, because the time had not yet come. They were basically saying, listen, any of you that will surrender Jesus to us, we'd gladly receive him. So Jesus goes to Bethany, and he's there with this family and these friends. It says, so they made a supper there, and Martha was serving, but Lazarus was one of those reclining at the table with him. Mary then took a pound of very costly perfume of pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples who was intending to betray him, said, "Why was the perfume not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor people?" Now he said this, not because he was concerned about the poor, but because he was a thief. And as he had the money box, he used to pilfer what was put into it. Therefore Jesus said, "Let her alone, so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. For you always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." And the large crowd of the Jews then learned that he was there. And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might also see Lazarus, whom he raised from the dead. And get this, but the chief priests planned to put Lazarus to death also, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and were believing in Jesus. Father, we thank you for your word. May it transform us in this moment. May you move in our hearts and lives. May you teach us and show us the things that we need to see about ourselves today, that we need to see about you. And Lord, may we leave differently than we walked in this room. Move, stir, open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to what you have, in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to begin this morning where it's obvious in this text. Now, what this text has to show us, first and foremost, is the devotion of Mary. What would make someone so devoted? How did she get to a place where she would do this act that literally, as we're going to see in a few moments, that Jesus said to her, "Wherever the gospel is preached, you will be remembered for this act, for what you did right here." She was suddenly overwhelmed. She was suddenly consumed with love for Jesus that she did this act that was very costly to her. Now, when you think about Mary, there's a great lesson about Mary's life that we all ought to remember, that we all ought to hold on to. That selfless devotion, it stems, listen to this, from personal love and gratitude for who Jesus is and what he has done. What was the posture of Mary always? Where was Mary? You had Martha always serving, but Mary, she was always sitting at the feet of Jesus. She couldn't get enough of his word. She couldn't get enough of his presence. She believed with her whole heart. Remember, she declared in the last chapter that you are the Christ. You're the Son of God. She knew that this Jesus was her Messiah. She knew that he had the power to raise people from the dead because she'd seen it with her own eyes. And not just a random person, but the brother that she deeply loved was sitting there reclined at the table. And out of love and out of gratitude, we see that she absolutely was overwhelmed with devotion. Because I want you to know that the love of Christ, if you want to talk about the purest form of worship, it's when we are absolutely overwhelmed with his love. I don't want you to lose the simplicity of the gospel, the simplicity of what God has always asked of us. Love the Lord your God with everything you have. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love. He says, without love, we have nothing. And Mary loved Jesus. And that motive led her to do this act, and it changed everything for her. And I want you to know that you won't love the Lord as you should until you learn to spend time at his feet. You say, well, I don't have Jesus the way that she had Jesus. Folks, I want you to know that his word is living and active. Sharper than any two-edged sword, it cuts to the very core of who we are, and we have a God that still speaks today, who still invites us to sit at his feet every moment, every day. He is waiting for nothing more than for you to open his word, because everything in his word is about him, telling of his goodness, of his love, of his purposes, of his plans for humanity, for you. And you show me a person who is deeply in love with Jesus, I'll show you a person that has learned to sit at his feet and to sit in his word, who loves prayer, community with God. And that's who Mary was. And it drove her to do what she did, because what she did, we find in this text, it was costly. And I want to ask you a question. This is probably the most basic question that we can ask ourselves. Do we love Jesus more than all of our stuff? You see, what takes us away from the Lord usually isn't these deep, big things. Usually it's just the little stuff that consumes our lives. There are so many times in our life that Jesus is calling us to go, calling us to do, calling us to give. But you know what? There is a part of us that says, you know what? But I love those things. I love my weekends. I love my entertainment. I love my sports. I love my... And we could just go on and on and on and on. Listen, I've known men who've said, listen, I know that God had a call in my life at a young age to go and preach, but I couldn't see giving up my Sundays. How do we get to that place? You see, what I love about this story is that she gave something that everybody else said, if you were to give that, that's too costly. That's crazy. This perfume that she basically put over Jesus, it was expensive. When she said that she poured out this, the amount would have been about a 12-ounce soda can. That's how much probably liquid was in there. In that day, today the equivalent would have been, that would have cost over $25,000 at a minimum. Poured out on Jesus in a moment. And now for us, even in America, that sounds like a lot, but I want you to remember that most places in the world, that you have no idea how much money that is. This was probably an heirloom for her. This is probably something that had been passed down from within inside of her family. This was something that would have been very much a nest egg. Something of great cost, great worth. It came from India. Nard was a perfume that came from India. Had to be brought from the Himalayas. You can imagine what it would cost to purchase something like that in those ancient days. And she comes and she pours it, as the text in Matthew and Mark says, she actually poured it on his head. And I think for a very deliberate purpose, John speaks to where she poured it over his feet. All of that spice was poured out at the feet of Jesus. You can imagine the shock of the crowd. And before you get on Judas, it wasn't just Judas. When we look back at Matthew and Mark, we find that it was the disciples as well that were being critical of Mary. They were dumbfounded, really for a couple reasons, that she would take something so costly. And they said to her, I mean, she was doing what was an extravagant act of worship. And they looked at her and said, what an extravagant waste. And boy, if you're like me, you're thinking, well, what is Jesus going to say? Jesus had something to say. Because Jesus said, the disciples' attitude and Judas's attitude was, man, you could have taken that and you could have sold that and you could have given that to the poor. Imagine how that would have helped those people. And in a way, you think that's practical, that's sensible in a way. What is Jesus going to say to that argument, to that debate? They brought up a question. I'm sure everybody was thinking, well, how is Jesus going to respond to this? You can imagine they probably were very self-righteous in their statement. Now, what we are going to learn of Judas is he had ulterior motives for saying what he said. But even the disciples were critical, and they were saying, I mean, listen, the disciples are no different than us. We usually tend to want to give as little to God as he expects of us. That's how most of us operate in our lives. We would have taken that $25,000. This is the way it probably would have looked for us, is if I sell this and I go and I get it, what is God asking me? Well, I can give 10%, but then I can take the rest of it and I can get, you know, that new model mule that's out there that I've been wanting. But she, without hesitation, gave everything that she had. Where do you ever see Jesus push back on a person who gives him everything? Never. Never. Remember the widow? She gave two mites, and everybody looked and thought, wow, look at how little she gave. And Jesus looked at it and said, listen, the rest of y'all, you gave out of your abundance. She gave everything that she had. Nobody gave more than her that day. Folks, I don't know if you've realized it yet that our salvation is free, but following Jesus is costly. What Jesus would say to her is, and to those men, he would say that I am more worthy of your unselfish devotion than all the world's poor put together. It wasn't that they weren't expected to care for the poor. But he said, right now, in this moment, I'm sitting here and you are criticizing her act of devotion. And right now she has this moment to give all that she has to the one who saves her, the one who has raised Lazarus from the dead, the one who has healed Simon from this leprosy. Out of worship, she's giving all that she has got. And he accepted the worship from Mary because she rightly saw that he is worthy of all that she could give and even more. How many of y'all remember Isaac Watts wrote one of the most glorious hymns that we have? And in the final verse of that hymn, this is how he stated it. Were the whole realm of nature mine, it would be an offering far too small. For love so amazing, so divine, what did he say? It demands my soul, my life, my all. You see, it's one thing to sing it. We can so easily put words to a hymn on a screen and we can sing it, but do we even realize what it is that we're singing? And does that singing reflect our hearts? That, Lord, all that I have is yours, my time, my talent, my treasure, every bit of it, Lord, you show me and you tell me where to go and what to do, and I will do it. And have we ever gotten so overwhelmed with Jesus that we literally can't help do anything other than just say, Lord, here am I, all of me, it's yours. What she did wasn't just costly, it was humbling. See, it wasn't just that she poured out this extravagant gift upon him, but I don't want you to miss what happened when she undid her hair and she wiped the feet of Jesus. You see, she was so caught up in the moment, all she saw was her and Jesus. She didn't care about anybody else, what they thought or what they would say, because tradition back then would have been that if you're a woman who is either married or what, you don't take your hair and undo it. In the presence of men, women always had their hair up in this day. And if you took your hair down in this day, you were considered to be a woman of loose character. And so they weren't just shocked by the gift. They were shocked by the fact that she undid her hair in the presence of Jesus, in the presence of everybody else, and went against their customs, went against their traditions, and literally overwhelmed with tears flowing down her face, she takes her hair. She doesn't have a towel. And she takes her hair and she literally dries the feet of Jesus, overwhelmed with her hair. Folks, I want you to know that a life spent in selfless devotion to Jesus, it's not wasted. She didn't treasure her things more than Jesus. She didn't treasure her pride more than Jesus. She was so caught up in her devotion to Christ that she never stopped and even considered or cared what someone else might think about what she was doing. She loved Jesus more than what others thought of her. Let me ask you a question. Are you overly concerned about what people think? You shouldn't be. Because we should live our life. Let me tell you how to simplify your life. Live for an audience of one person. If he says, well done, it doesn't matter what anybody else says. We feel like we have to give an answer to everyone. I've seen parents talk their children out of God's call in their life. That to me is tragic. I feel called to be on mission. No, you feel called to go to school. Over and over, I've witnessed and I've seen people pour water on a fire that God Himself is lighting. What she did was not just costly and humbling, it was beautiful. See, that's what we find in the scriptures in Matthew and Mark. It's not in John, but when he said, leave her alone, one of the things that he said, what she did was good. Other translations say, what she did was beautiful to me. Folks, if Jesus says it's beautiful, nothing else matters. They looked at it and said, why this waste? I mean, basically, go back and look at what the disciples said to her, what Judas said to her. This is a waste, and Jesus says, it's not a waste. Leave her alone. What she did for me is absolutely beautiful. Her heart is overcome with love for me. The most precious thing that she possessed, she just gave it all to me. And folks, love is not truly love if all it does is calculate cost. Indeed. It's not what God asks. Love gives it all, and its only regret is that it doesn't have more to give. And what I love is it says, and the disciples missed it, there was this beautiful fragrance that came, and it didn't just spread in that room, but it spread to the entire house, and probably out of that house. And see, they missed it, and what I think Jesus, I think the words are put here for a very specific reason that it says that, listen, it filled the house. That's what our worship, that's what our love for Jesus is supposed to do. That's what it's meant to do, is to fill the house. If someone poured that much perfume, I mean, think about it. Normally we use what? Little dabs of it. And we think it can be too strong. Listen, her love, her extravagant worship there for Jesus, it was overwhelming to the point that no one could have missed. It filled every corner of the house. Does your love for Jesus, does your worship for Jesus, does it fill the office in which you work? Does it fill the home in which you live? Does it go out into the community? You say, well, what does that look like, Aaron? Listen, a person who's been transformed by Jesus Christ, who loves him, who is giving their all to him. Listen, they have, I promise you, they will give off a scent. It's the fruit of the Spirit. And in this dark world, trust me, when someone sees love, it stands out today. We live in an impatient world. Live with the fruit of the Spirit and let the world see and smell the fragrance of a person who is loving, who is kind, who is patient, who is gentle, who is faithful, who has self-control. I promise you, you show me a person who is in love with Jesus like this. It permeates. It's undeniable. None of us will be the first ones to be questioned for the way that we try to be obedient to Jesus. There was a missionary named John Patton. It became known that he intended to take his wife and himself to some of the South Sea Islands. And back in those times and in those days, the tribal people of these islands, many of them were cannibals. So you can imagine, as you go home and try to tell your family, the Lord is calling me to go on mission and to give my life as a missionary. I mean, I'm sure if they heard many other places, they wouldn't have been as concerned. But when they hear the cannibals, right? Everybody began to question them, and all of them began to question their sanity, question whether or not, is that something that God would actually ask of you? If you could imagine it, some of the greatest pushback that they got were from the people closest to them, even in the church. And it said that there was this old man in the church that would not leave them alone. And the old man kept saying to them, "You will be eaten by cannibals if you go." John Patton finally had enough. And he pulled that older gentleman aside and he said to that older gentleman, he said, "My dear sir, you yourself are getting up in years, and soon you're going to be laid in a grave and you're going to be eaten by worms. If I can but live and die honoring the Lord Jesus Christ, it doesn't matter to me whether I'm eaten by cannibals or whether I'm eaten by worms, because on that resurrection day, my body will arise just as fair as yours." The deceit of Jesus, or of Judas. It's purposely put against the devotion of Mary. And we're going to get a fuller picture into Judas, into where he is spiritually, and that his betrayal of Jesus wasn't just an act that suddenly appeared, but that he had lived a life unbeknownst to everybody but Jesus. That all he cared about was himself. You see, you can be in church and all you care about is yourself. You do realize that, right? You can claim to follow Jesus and be all into everything for yourself and for no other reason. It's easy to say you're one thing and to be something else, right? Well, we call that in the Bible hypocrisy. And I wanted you to see, we said a moment ago that when you look at the life of Mary, it was a life spent in selfless devotion. And a life like that is never wasted, but I can assure you that if you live life for yourself, if everything that you do is about yourself, if your marriage is about yourself, if your work is about yourself, if your free time is about yourself, if your money is about yourself, if everything is about yourself, I'm going to tell you the truth today. That is the quickest way to waste your life. If you want to totally waste your life, spend it on yourself. And we see here Judas and his hypocrisy. You say, what is hypocrisy? Well, I want you to understand what it is and what it is not. Hypocrisy does not mean that Judas was a sinner. Everybody in that room was a sinner outside of Jesus, right? The church is full of people who are growing in their faith, and day by day, as much as they're being changed, they still wrestle in sin, right? Anybody in here want to try to sell me on the fact that you have reached sinless perfection? Just give me your wife's phone number, your husband's phone number, your children's phone number. They will tell me the truth. Hypocrisy isn't a believer that has sinned. Hypocrisy is a believer who sins and acts as if they don't sin. Who tries to be something that they're not. And listen, they are right. Church is full of hypocrites. But that's not the same as saying that it's full of people who struggle in sin. That does not equate hypocrisy. What is hypocrisy? It's when you don't stand before God and you don't stand before others honest about who you are. What God wants from us is transparency. What he wants from us is a contrite spirit. What he wants from us is the ability to have a sincere heart before God. That God, this is who I am. You see my struggles. Listen, it doesn't do any good for all of us to go in a room and act as if none of us are struggling, and then we're all drowning in our lives when we could be sharing and helping each other by being honest and transparent about the journey that we're on. But if we won't do that, then there's no life in that. So we see his hypocrisy because it literally tells us in the text that when he refers to the poor and he says, boy, you could have given that to the poor, that was just a cover for Judas. That's why I believe the disciples aren't mentioned here as they were in the others, because the focus really is down on Judas now, where he's saying, look at the hypocrisy in his life. He says it's about the poor. It's not about the poor. It's about himself. He wants the money in the kitty. Why? So he can steal it because he's a thief. Because when money goes in, he pilfers it, which means he steals it. And we get a look into what has been happening slowly, but probably over the entire time about Judas. One of the major reasons why Judas probably betrayed Jesus was because all his hopes and dreams weren't in a Savior who would save him from his sin, but probably in a Savior that would defeat Rome and build a kingdom. And probably Judas was thinking, listen, what will I be in this kingdom? And when he realized that Jesus wasn't kidding when he said, I've come to die, Judas was done. But he still kept the mask on. You say, how well was he a hypocrite? Pretty well, because listen, if you know the guy holding the bag's a thief, you don't let him hold the bag. John understood this much later. He didn't understand it when it happened. He understood it when he wrote this. Judas's heart was the opposite of Mary's. And Jesus looks at Judas and says, you leave her alone. Your heart is wrong, Judas. We see his hypocrisy. We see his flawed character. We see how a man's view can be warped. This action of surpassing loveliness, he looks at it and says that it's an extravagant waste. He ungraciously questions her action. Mary loved Jesus. Judas loved money. And we see his selfish heart in all of this. I hope you realize that a man's sight depends on what is inside of him. He sees what he's fit and able to see. If you don't believe that, I can show you very easily, because we do it all the time. A person that we like, they can do no wrong. But a person that we don't like, they can do no right. You ever realize you're doing that? That it doesn't matter if they changed. It doesn't matter if they did absolutely what was right and good and holy. We wouldn't see it. Because we've become selfish. And all we care about are our feelings and our thoughts and our ways and everything else. And folks, I want you to think with me that if we ever get to the place that we find ourselves, listen to this, very critical of other people. If we find ourselves continually imputing unworthy motives to people, we need to stop investigating them and we need to start looking at ourselves as to why that is. I told you a moment ago, he's so delusional at this point that he's criticizing Mary for a gift of $25,000 that she poured out on him in love and in worship without even thinking about it. And in just a few days, he's going to sell Jesus out for less than $1,000. Talk about blindness. Talk about the inability to see clearly. And we have the declaration of Jesus. I love this. In the midst of this story where you've got Mary giving and everybody else saying, stop, what are you doing? How foolish of you. Do you know what that costs? Jesus stops everybody, because I would have been wondering, what is Jesus thinking? If I had been sitting back against the wall watching it, that's what I would have been thinking, is I wonder what Jesus is going to do here. And I love his words. He says, you leave her alone. I hope some of you hear Jesus speaking that over you today. When people question your calling, when people question your motives, when people question your sacrifice, when people question your worship, that if those things are coming out of all-out devotion for Jesus, I want you to hear him say to you and to everybody around you, you leave them alone. HBC, if anyone tells you to moderate your love for Jesus, please don't listen to them. Because I assure you, somebody will try to moderate your love for Jesus. You need to calm down. Do you realize that people come to me all the time and are like, you know, I don't like that so-and-so claps in front of me. Well, move seats. But don't dampen. Don't put water on the fire that Jesus has lit. Let your affections for Jesus be lavish. I also want you to know you can count on it. He had to say, leave her alone, because you can count on it. If you give yourself without reserve to Jesus, people aren't going to understand. You will be criticized. And let me go ahead and tell you, the loudest criticism will not be out there. You know where it'll come from? Right here, right inside these walls. Keep serving. Keep giving. Keep going. Keep loving. Keep worshiping. He said, leave her alone, Judas. Her heart is right. She feels my worth. And the most important thing in this text is probably the hardest thing to translate in verse 7, where it said, let her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. Now, he can't mean the ointment, because the ointment's already been poured out. She poured it all out. So it can't be the ointment that he's referring to. But there is such a beautiful statement when you can understand what he's getting at here. Because what he is telling Judas, and what he ultimately would have been telling his disciples at the same time, is leave her alone and don't hinder her from keeping her love and her wonder and her joy in the face of my death. She needs this awe and this wonder. She needs this faith. She needs this love. Because her faith is about to be tested like it never has before. She has declared to Jesus, when he asked, do you believe this? She said, I believe you're the Christ. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you've come into the world. And in that moment, Jesus raised her brother. And that is an amazing miracle that she is holding to, that she is believing that Jesus can do what he says he can do. And she, in overwhelmed joy, is anointing him. But in a few days, everybody in that room, all of their faith is about to be tested in a way that they can't even imagine. Because Jesus is going to go to a cross, and he's going to die, and he's going to be buried. And you know what? Judas will go hang himself. These men that are being critical of Mary, they're going to scatter. But these women, they're going to watch him die. and they're going to prepare his body. And he says to those men, you leave her alone. Don't take her thrill, her gratitude, her amazement, her wonder, her love, her faith, her belief that he is the resurrection and the life. You be silent, Judas. You be silent, disciples, and let her keep that same love and that same hope as she watches me die and be buried. And Jesus would declare in the other two books, not only leave her alone and what we just read about keeping it until his burial, but he would say, leave her alone. She did all that she could. I don't know about you. That's what I want to do. I want to, at the end of this life, I want to be able to say, listen, I gave all I could give. I heard your call to go. I heard your call to preach. I heard your call to pastor. I heard your call to father. I heard your call to be a husband. I heard your call to be a friend. I heard your call to care for the poor. I heard your call for the widowed. I heard your call. I heard your call, and I gave all that you gave me back to you. So God, that you would be glorified. This life isn't about our glory. It is about his glory. She did all she could. And folks, you better do it while you can, because Jesus says, listen, that's what he was saying to them. You always have the poor. I'm here right now. How many times do we miss the opportunity that God sets before us? Because we wait, and we wait because we're worried. What mom will say, what dad will say, what the church will say, what our friends will say, what everybody will say. Folks, get lost in the wonder of God. And when he says go, when he says give, when he says do, do it. We have to remember the things that we're called to do. He calls us to do now, because many times the chance may never come again. And failure to do them, especially failure to express love, nothing brings more bitter remorse than that. And lastly, he said in Matthew and Mark, he said, leave her alone. Think about this statement. Leave her alone. This act, it will never be forgotten. Is there any party that wants to live that way? That out of all of humanity, all the people who come before you and after you, that it might be said of you that this extravagant act, this pouring out of oneself and all that they have for my sake, for love for me, for worship for me, they died so that I could live. And because of the extravagant act, wherever the gospel will be preached, because that's exactly how he says it, wherever the gospel will be preached, will be proclaimed, they will remember you for this act. And we're how many thousands of years out, and guess what we're still doing? Folks, you want your life to count? Lay it down. Remember, Jesus said, if you hold on to your life, you can bet you'll lose it. But if you'll lose your life for his sake, you'll gain it. Let me ask you a question. Judas or Mary? Who are you going to be? Judas or Mary? Father, we thank you, Lord, for the goodness and grace that you give to us. And Lord, I pray in our hearts, all declare today that we give you all that we are, all that we have. Lord, that we want to die to ourselves so that you can live through us. And Lord, that we might leverage our entire life for your kingdom, Lord, to show people your glory, your majesty, that our life might be a fragrance that would fill this world. Lord Jesus, that means we got to spend time with you. How can we worship someone we don't know? How can we love someone so deeply that we would give everything if we don't even know them? And so, Father, my heart today cries out for the people here of this church that, Lord, you would give them a desire to know you above all. Now, Lord, there wouldn't be excuses of work and kids and time and schedules. The Lord just keeps pushing you out of life. But, Lord, you would be our life. And, Lord, we wouldn't be satisfied until we spend time with the most important person. Lord, it would be, we would be better off letting go of everything in this life. To have you, that's what your word says. That you're the pearl of great price. The word says that you're like a treasure that was hidden in a field. Once it was found, the man who found it knew that he could sell off everything because it was nothing compared to what he had just found in that field. So, Father, may we have that heart. Lord, may we be honest with ourselves today if we don't have that heart. And may we start fresh and new, leaning and trusting in you to transform us, that we would fall in love with you all over again. Don't let us be like the church at Ephesus, losing our first love, Lord. May we keep you at the center of it all. And Father, I just pray that there are some here today that don't know you as Lord and Savior. I pray that today they would recognize that you are life, that outside of Christ there is no life. Lord, that we need you. Forgive us of our sins. And Lord, you won't just wink at our sin. You had to come and die for our sins. Jesus came and lived a perfect life to die for sinners, to take our punishment. And Lord, someone here today needs to repent of their sin. They need to turn from their life that they're living and to follow you with their whole heart, believing that you and you alone can save them and transform them. So Father, I pray that today they would, right where they are, ask you to step into their life to save them from their sins, that they would confess their sins and repent of their sins, and they would follow you, believing that you are able. Lord Jesus, there are some here today that need to join this fellowship. I don't know what they're waiting on. Lord, I pray that they would come and be part of what you're doing here in this church and commit to this body of believers to help serve the world around us. Lord, don't let them wait another week. Lord, help them to set down roots and to be part of what you're doing here. And Lord, there are some here today that have never been baptized. They know you as Lord and Savior, but they've never followed through in believer's baptism. I pray that today you would give them the courage to step out and say, today's the day that I acknowledge that I'm a believer and I want to follow Jesus in obedience to baptism. Lord, I just pray that whatever they need to do today, whatever I need to do, Lord, don't let us leave until we've done it. So as we pray to you, Lord, help us to respond. You've spoken, help us to respond today in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, he's waiting to hear from you. These words aren't my words, they are his words. His word speaks. God speaks. What will you do with what he said to you today?